River in New York is the place picked for the sport year's most spotlighted event, the Army-Navy game. But players in this year's game come from a different West Point and a different Annapolis than in former chapters of the 53-year-old grid rivalry. West Point and Annapolis are at war. At West Point, work-laden students have had to cram 4 years stiff GI training into three, and then add to that 500 more hours per year for flying training. One hour is permitted to the gritsters for football practice down on Nike Field, but that's all. In Annapolis, the same rules and increased pressures apply. These marching middies on the banks of the Severn have been shoved into high gear as never before. Here, too, there's been a shortening of the course from 4 years to three. And whether it's navigation or engineering, gunnery or communication, standards must be up to strict academy traditions. But this year, one tradition's being overlooked. They'll stay at home and try to work, although they do have permission for this big pregame rally to cheer the blue team on. At West Point, too, there's celebration. For Army and for Navy, the spirit's there. The day of the game, the day is cold and gray, threatened to rain, but the field is dry. And here come the cadets to watch the only wartime event where Army and Navy won't be fighting side by side. Army wants to break the Navy's streak. Slowly, the West Pointers enter the field. Yes, West Pointers, everyone. Those white hats aren't midshipmen. They're West Point's 1st Regiment, loaned out as a Navy rooting section to cheer the blue team on as best they can. Down on the field, Rear Admiral Beardall and Major General Wilby, superintendents of the rival institutions, are trying to convince each other of their team's merit. When out into the field comes a Navy battleship, complete with smokestack and smoke. As for crew, it's Pancho, Army's famous mule and mascot. And here comes Navy's Bill, with even better accommodations than Pancho's. And here come the teams, Army in black and gold, Navy in white. There's the toss. It's Army's choice, and Army chooses to receive. There's Colonel Red Blake, Army's coach, in last-minute survey of the field, while across the field, Navy's Captain Welcher gives Hamburg last-minute tip. It's kickoff time, and the crowd jumps to its feet as the expert toe of Navy's triple threat, Hal Hamburg, boots the pigskin down to Army's Anderson, who fights his way up to his own 31 before he's down. For the first few plays, Army's black and gold tries battering the middies line. Here's Anderson scampering past midfield down to Navy's 48, where he's forced out as eager cadets go wide. Through the line again? No, this time Glenn Davis with the cadets skirts the Stonewall sailor line, sweeping wide around left end for an 18-yard gain, shoving well into Navy territory. Around end again is Lombardo handled to Maxton, who goes wide around right this time to pick up a long 8 yards. After a 15-yard penalty, Army has to kick. Down on Navy's 12, Hillis Hume takes it, plugs it back 12 yards, and now it's the middies' turn to test their offense against the soldier line. The first play speaks well for the middies, with Hume again driving through a big hole on the short side. There's a lateral to bound. It's a fumble. Army's Davis picks it up to run it back, but the play is void. Both sides offside. Once more, Army tries the line as the cadets send Maxim through tackle for a little gain. Watch that block and watch that girl shudder. And now it's the cadets' ball again in the middle of the second quarter with Army tactics changed to a pass offense. There's Davis's throw to Rafalco, and it's complete for a welcome 20-yard soldier gain. The Army's area of warfare once more as Doug Kenneth aims to wing a quick one down to Rafalco again for 10 more yards and another first down. After Army's kick, Navy takes the ball midfield and drives the air itself as Hamburg gets one off to Roe Johnson, but Anderson at the grade gets there first and intercepts on his own 42. It's all right, coach. It's only a football game. Army seems sold on the pass offense as Davis gets the ball and fades back for another long one down to Miner on Navy 30, but this time Navy intercepts. Hamburg gets off a kick which turns the tide of the game as he boots the pigskin 52 long yards and out of bounds on the Army 7. The soldiers win a spot in Soften Corner and try the line as Miner bucks through for 6 yards, but no first down.
This time Army gets into real trouble as Johnston breaks through to smear Davis cold way back on the Army two. This isn't so good. George Maxson's in the shadows of his own goalpost as he kicks out of danger. Well boot, but Hamburg runs it back into Army territory and Navy starts its big drive of the game. The game is most crucial play. With Hamburg off in a single wing to the right, but just before he's tackled, he flips the flip ladder over to Hillis Hume, who dances all the way down to Army 7. Navy's power is really threatening now. Single wing to the left, and Hume gets it to shoulder through tackle for five more yards down to Army 2. It's getting tough at the Lindley cheering section to cheer with feeling, but this time Hume drops the ball. He's got it again. It's still Navy's ball. Bob Jenkins, number 18, is through tackle, and Stanowitz can't stop him as he makes it. It's a mini touchdown. Navy 6, Army nothing, as Finest goes back for Navy's extra point. There's a kick right through the bars. It's good. West Point is stunned and silent in the stands, but news of the Navy's touchdown gets a different reception 300 miles to the south, where middies have been waiting anxiously around their radios. It's fourth quarter now, and the midshipmen are striking the tired Army line with sledgehammer blows. Hume shakes his way through guard for a long gain while the Navy bench goes wild, and then the sailors drive him through for four more and a first down. Navy's threatening another score now, and sailors cheerleaders try to get the borrowed rooting section to make some noise. Navy's punched down to Army's 14 through Hume's successful stabs at the battered soldier line. There he is again for 11 more and a first down on Army 3. Navy's determined to score, and there goes Jimmy Pettit up, and it's over for the second touchdown. The game is over, and Navy has won 13-0, as delirious sailors scream out to congratulate their teammates. At Annapolis, frenzied middies drag out the legendary victory bell and generally go to town all over the campus. Tecumseh, ship's figurehead and century-old patron saint to generations of midshipmen, towers proudly overhead as hysterical victory dances swirl by him all afternoon long. The Navy's doing it for the fifth time in 5 years. Tomorrow, Bill the Goat goes back to his tent.